Side effects that could be answered pushing that 30-year term, properly designed post-market trial. Unfortunately, at that point, FDA dropped the burden. FDA and the drug manufacturer did agree on the post-market study code, but it was designed to show whether Avandia provided long-term control of blood sugar levels, not to assess whether Avandia increases the risk of heart attacks.
Thank you.
2005, released an extensive bipartisan investigation into the pay of refineries to find many of the same questions we face today. How effective are programs by the FDA and industry to gather climate and useful data on lingering safety concerns about approved products? When a safety concerns approach, how should preliminary often anecdotal information be used by regulators, clinicians, and patients? And how do we strike the correct balance between speedy approval of life-saving or life-enhancing therapies that patients want and a much slower process of announcing statistically valid data and sometimes long-term health outcomes? Today's hearing will talk to progress of warnings that blind people's medication to radio, manufactured by toxins with chronic pain, increased the risk of cardiovascular disease in some patients. Patients are already in the control of the drug products. And admittedly, limited amount of analysis of disparate resource finance suggests that increased members of attention. All those studies don't deliver the benefit of increased member risk. So patients and doctors are left with conflicting or incomplete information upon which to base delicate judgments about the net benefits of various treatment options. At this hearing, as the chairman notes, is not about one product. It's about the effectiveness of the overall by approval and monitoring process. As the chairman's memo to members cautioned, this hearing is not about whether Avandia makes patients healthy or not healthy. We're not here to substitute our judgment for that scientists and regulators still evaluating clinical safety data. But we're here to ask whether current post-marketing surveillance programs and protocols are both robust and sensitive enough to detect emerging evidence of deleterious health effects, and how that evidence informs regulatory, research, and treatment decisions. Take a look at this one million Americans today. Avandia was approved in 1999 because it lowers health of blood sugar levels in patients suffering type 2 diabetes. Managing type 2 diabetes by lowering blood sugar can decrease the patient's chance of having diabetes related problems later in life, such as kidney failure, heart disease, stroke, and renal medication. But the so-called surrogate endpoint of this blood glucose is only an indirect measure of the drug's overall impact on health. And questions about the extent of any increased cardiovascular risk posed by Avandia were raised 8 years ago. So the FDA requires the doctor to compare the safety and effectiveness of Avandia with all the warm anti-diabetes medical masters. In 2000, the company initiated a number of large long-term clinical trials to look specifically at cardiovascular health problems in people with diabetes using Avandia to manage the disease. So far, results from that study have not shown increased health risks, as well as suggested by the meta analysis that would require discontinuation of the research for safety reasons. Nevertheless, I still, based on data from the study involving patients with existing congestive heart failure, the FDA required a labeling change for the drug to include a new warning about a potential increase in heart attacks and heart-related chest pain in certain individuals. The FDA will convene an advisory committee to organize next month to review this matter. That committee's findings should provide healthcare providers and patients with a better understanding of any cardiovascular risks involved with the use of Avandia. It's not clear if the advisory committee will also look at the entire class of warm anti-diabetes medications that operate like Avandia. Perhaps FDA can answer that question today. This model of post-market infection is not unique. A recent New England Journal of Medicine editorial called the FDA approach to post-approval or phase 4 research dissimilar. Because during the period from 1998 through 2003, only about a quarter of the required phase 4 trials were completed. And as of September 30, 2006, a total of 899 phase 4 studies remained pending. As a result, the safety profile of some drugs, particularly those approved using surrogate endpoints, can remain incomplete for years. Most Americans believe once the FDA approves a drug, it clearly carries the logical equivalent of the cardiovascular consumer approval. It can be used with little or no risk. But the process of developing, marketing, regulating, prescribing, and using modern pharmaceuticals for the first time, it carries considerable risk at every stage. Those risks have to be acknowledged frankly and managed responsibly. Adverse events, surveillance, and research have to be sensitive enough to detect potential safety problems and discreet enough to distinguish between well-publicized anecdotes and scientific evidence. Otherwise, public confidence in both the FDA and the pharmaceutical industry will be undermined by conflicting data and allegations. No one is protecting the long-term worth of the patients. I look forward to hearing from our panels of expert witnesses today and how we can strengthen FDA drug approval and post-marketing surveillance systems. I want to ask unanimous consent that this Thank you. So,
focus on it is to ask questions, but not to draw a conclusion. And when I read you the definition from Cable's Cyclopedic Medical Dictionary, it says, "Meta analysis, a statistical procedure for combining data from a number of studies and investigations in order to analyze the therapeutic effectiveness of specific treatments," and this is a really important part, "and plan future studies." The meta-analysis does not actually do research. It does not gather the data that is so important to gather when drug companies are searching for the effectiveness of the drugs they're working with. So I think it's extremely important that we keep in mind what a meta-analysis is. Now, Mr. Chairman, on May 21st, Dr. Nissen's study was published by the New England Journal of Medicine, along with the journal editorial, encouraging physicians to stop prescribing the drug and encouraging the FDA to take regulatory action. Then there were alarming headlines pronouncing an increased risk of death for anyone taking this drug. According to a very interesting article in the Time Political Defibrillator published in the May 28, 2000 issue of BioCentury, a journal providing analysis for the biotechnical community said after the release of Dr. Nissen's study, some of our congressional colleagues in the House and Senate issued statements in the press suggesting that they knew ahead of time about the study. Included among the press releases, there was an appeal to check the manufacturer's scandal, including the statement that, quote, "both the drug company and the FDA have some major explaining to them about what they knew about Avandia, when they knew it, and why they didn't take immediate action to protect patients," end quote. These statements were made with disregard for the limits of this study and the impact that these statements and actions could have on public safety or the reputation of the company involved. Let me read the opening paragraph of the BioCentury piece. "The circumstances surrounding the publication by the New England Journal of Medicine of a meta-analysis of safety data from studies of Avandia and an accompanying commentary suggesting that FDA critics on Capitol Hill have collaborated with whistleblowers in the agency and pharmaceutical industry critics in academia create controversy over Avandia safety in order to advance a political agenda. According to this argument, among members of the Senate and House and their staffs were apparently aware of the study and that it was going to be published. The author never notified the FDA. Yet the FDA is the one agency that holds the key to action if this study in fact revealed data without an immediate threat to the public. The British Medical Journal, The Lancet, published May 23, 2007, took issue with how this was handled, stating that, quote, to avoid unnecessary panic among patients, a calmer and more considered approach to the safety of Ronazepam is needed. Alarmist timelines and confident declarations have no meaningful. Mr. Chairman, while there is no need to manufacture a scandal here, it appears that there may already be one that needs investigating, at least by the press. I'd like to see the press determine what members of Congress and their staff knew about the study, when they knew it, and whether there was a coordinated effort among the author, this grand FDA staff, and staff at the New England Journal of Medicine to develop and publish the study in a way that would create a sensation in the press and maximum embarrassment to the FDA. My husband is diabetic, and so I'm very interested in this disease and very interested in our finding treatments for it. It is a very pernicious disease and one of the most expensive in our country. However, we serve no purpose by scaring people about drugs. And I'm no doctor, as far as they say. I'm not there to apologize to black soil. But I think we should be very careful when we talk about scientific issues and make sure that we have a balanced approach to this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to get to the witnesses. Is there any member of the committee to say anything further?
My name is Mr. Sherry, and I am not that brave. I just want to address a couple things. First of all, there's been a nomination that this sort of study was aired upon, and
suggesting. And this is where people should come. There should not be circumstantial evidence to be disingenuous and so forth. People come to this committee, that they have come to us with an issue. This is the oversight committee. This is where they should be coming. But they should have the intelligence and have that kind of balance here to just let the evidence be presented and not suggest that it's being done for a disingenuous reason and then have it be given in that context. This is a tremendously important issue. My family has done it. It's found out thousands of families that have dealt with this problem. We should approach this as it comes. And at the end of the day, it may prove that the concern was covered. It may prove that the concern was understanding. If we don't listen, you see the evidence, you can and we're just discussing that's the way we should do that. Some of those families are trying to not go to our witnesses. We have with us the
Mr. Chairman, it appears to me the real concern is that there may be a side effect from this book. And we don't know if that side effect is present based on this latest study. It may be a side effect. I also understand that, according to the FDA, no approved diabetes drug has ever shown any kind of reduction in cardiovascular risk, the kind of risk that may exist here today. So, I guess, in the testimony, I'm hoping that it becomes clear, number one, whether we can really say that this side effect does exist from this drug. And if it doesn't, then we make it clear. The second is, even if it does exist, does it exist in such a significant number of cases that we know about? Then we can say the FDA is off track, that this committee, with its oversight capability, should intervene. And finally, Mr. Chairman, I think the question is, knowing that there's a side effect, is it appropriate for doctors to prescribe it to employee events who have known side effects? If patients are better off if this drug is prescribed, perhaps it will change prescribing patterns to physicians and employers. But if there's a known side effect, if the FDA takes that into account, they can decide whether to take the drug prescribed to them. Are the people better off? Take this drug by prescription, and if they are, for them, this could have a management basis in cardiovascular. Perhaps we've got some answers to those questions from the scientists. I'd like to welcome our first witnesses to the information part. This is the current commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration. He's the former head of the National Cancer Institute. He was a renowned cancer specialist from the United States. Here to testify, Dr. Tara Pan, the head of the Office of Surveillance and Epidemiology at the Food and Drug Administration, and Dr. Jenkins is the head of the Office of New Drugs at FDA. I want to welcome each of you right now today. We're looking forward to hearing views on some of these scientific and regulatory questions that have been struck on our minds. It is the practice of this committee to ask all witnesses to break up the advice that they'd like to ask you about. Dear Professor, I'm going to describe the testimony that you began to read before this committee will be the truth or not truth about the point. And I can only indicate that each of the witnesses I have touched on in the moment of my declaration, but I wanted to start with that. With ordinarily, I'm going to ask Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Linda Davis, and members of the committee. I really want to express my appreciation written testimony provides important details about the scientific facts and post-marketing trials that are involved in FDA's ongoing multifaceted regulation of the diabetes drug risk-benefit, perhaps better known as Avandia. Rather than recount these details, I would like to focus my oral statement on the process that has led to the FDA to do the right thing for patients by making decisions using a comprehensive multidisciplinary approach that incorporates all the data available and addresses the best interests of all patients affected by that decision. With me are two senior and expert FDA colleagues, Dr. John Jenkins, Director of the Office of New Drugs, and Dr. Derek Burkhead, the Director of the Office of Surveillance and Epidemiology, formerly the Office of Drug Safety. Both of these offices are part of FDA's Center for Drug Evaluation and Research, and their presence this morning is important regarding the FDA's decision-making process, because they represent the close interaction between the FDA office that reviews marketing applications for new drugs and the office that manages their safety profile. We're here as partners, reflecting the management and the professionals of the FDA who are dedicated to collaborating even more closely. Not simply to improve products, disapprove regulatory processes, but rather to do the right thing so that our actions will both promote and protect the health of Americans. Mr. Chairman, I know that you call this hearing because of your deep concern for the welfare of Americans, a motivation that transcends politics and that you share with any member of this committee. And I know you and members of Congress want and even demand that the FDA do its utmost to protect and promote the health of all Americans, including those millions of Americans affected by diabetes and the hundreds of thousands that perhaps using the drug Avandia. Let me be clear at the outset. Our focus and the decisions FDA has made and will make on Avandia is to serve the approximately 18 to 20 million Americans who are at risk of blindness, kidney failure, renal amputation, and death from diabetes. We will carry out that mission by thoughtfully weighing the potential effect of FDA's actions on the entire patient and on all patients. It is our goal to not just make the right decision about a drug like Avandia, but more importantly, to always do the right thing for patients. How do we do the right thing? First, by doing it as a team that embraces the diversity of all points of view and ways of all points of view to arrive at an FDA decision. Second, by using decision standards that are science-based, drawing upon all the scientific data that bears on the issue, and by demanding of ourselves and others rigor, precision, and accuracy in the analysis of that data, because our decision that weighs both the benefits and risk of the drug will affect not one or few, but often millions of lives. Third, by committing to a standard of excellence that requires us to constantly improve the processes by which we make decisions. Since I arrived at FDA, we have specifically addressed process improvement as it relates to decisions regarding drug safety. We have completed or rapidly putting in place more than 40 drug safety initiatives that are in keeping with the recommendations of the FDA National Report that we commissioned. A few recent examples of process improvement include factoring additional guidance on communicating drug safety information, mass creation of risk communications, advisory committee, proposed tougher procedures for membership on FDA advisory committees, and a critical path initiative promises to provide modern tools needed to improve the predictability of the processes by which products are discovered, developed, and monitored after delivery to patients. We have acknowledged that increasing demands and the complexity of the products we regulate requires increasing resources. And we are grateful for the administration's proposals and the congressional consideration given to the additional resources in fiscal year 2007 that has been considered for 2008. Among the many needs we are
resources to build a more robust FDA infrastructure of information technology to obtain and analyze all the data required for timely and accurate decisions. We need to focus on product safety throughout the entire life cycle of the product, including stronger post-market surveillance and pharmacovigilance. In fact, the robust pharmacovigilance system supported through public-private arrangement, such as an institute or foundation, could provide considerable benefit and would be most welcome as part of the progressive consideration of pending FDA legislation. Closing, Mr. Chairman, let me emphasize that as we deal with drug safety, we encourage those with an interest to bring to us comments and ideas and data from all sources. FDA is committed to appropriate scientific dialogue and discussion about the making of decisions. In the end, we must always be true to our mission to both protect and promote the health of all Americans. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for your time and interest and your commitment to this mission. And my colleagues and I will be pleased now to answer any questions. Thank you very much, Dr. Bonacci. I'm going to start with the 10 minutes. Thank you very much for your testimony. I'm a very distinguished scientist, and I know that you have the job of FDA, that you have been trying to see through relying on good science and recognizing the public interest. And of course, I think it's very supportive of the FDA because I think the American public expects the FDA to make sure that drugs that are available to them are safe and effective, not just at the time they're approved, but throughout the time the drug is available. Information that is based on science, not rumors or anecdotes, but demagoguery, but science. The issue with Avandia, like so many other drugs, is that it was approved without the full knowledge of all the events it might have. This is not unusual because many drugs need to be watched carefully after they're approved because they are pressured after they need to get drugs approved as quickly as possible. That would be an issue for them. Resources to get those drugs approved. The question that I'm looking at is the post-marketing surveillance of this drug as it reflects post-marketing surveillance of other drugs. This particular drug was approved in England in 1999. And the reviewing of the FDA, as I mentioned in my opening statements, exactly what it should be. In fact, what the effectiveness of whether it was blood sugar, and they found that there was enough clinical evidence to show that it did. But it was concerned about the possibility of increased heart attacks, strokes, because of some evidence that we saw in the data that suggested that there be a post-marketing surveillance of that issue. So that 1999, this opportunity for the FDA to make sure that the post-marketing study was being done. But it wasn't done. And then later in 2003, it went to the respective weapon. The input from those who had concerns, well, FDA had input from people who had concerns. And Dr. Peterson wrote to FDA, expressed its concern about Avandia's potential cardiovascular risks. And he urged the FDA to conduct a cardiovascular safety trial of high-risk populations. And still nothing was done. In February 2003, the World Health Organization issued a warning of potential cardiac risks associated with Avandia's class of drugs. This was another opportunity for FDA to insist that a post-market study be done by the manufacturer on this potential danger, and nothing was done. Not until we got this report in May. I suggest that there was great concern expressed in the public, which I was expecting the ability to do with. I know my staff and everything to do with knowing that this was trying to work first to get involved in their scientific evaluations. So there are a number of missed opportunities. Why didn't FDA insist upon the post-market surveillance to look at the risk of heart attacks and strokes? Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I would like
started out with emphasis on the fact that we are in fact looking at these issues from the point of view of the total recycling program. We're building in much more opportunity to ensure the safety of these drugs even before they are allowed to be applied to patients in the general population. And we're doing that in the most efficient and effective way we can so that it is more rapid. So we may get these life-saving and life-enhancing drugs to people, but that rapidity is not meaning reckless. We're applying the rigor and precision of discipline in the internal processes, and also recognizing, as you pointed out, that once that drug goes out into a much larger population, no clinical study or trial could ever give us all the information we need. So we are engaged with rigorous post-market surveillance with regard to this drug. There were post-marketing studies being conducted. FDA continued to be engaged in acquiring, analyzing, and assessing data coming in with regard to the experience that was being developed with Avandia in these large populations, both here and in Europe, and did in fact get ready to action. We'd like to ask Dr. Vera to talk about the regulatory action. Did you ask for and did you get a study on potential side effects of getting that data with the right was recommended by somebody else that I mentioned, but to actually tell the manufacturer to do the study so you can have a definitive study. And then I'd like Dr. Jenkins to make the approval and what was involved in what they'll be described in the first market. So I was just saying that the first work, because the approval is not the best. And we can do some of the evidence, you know, and there are some of the studies. So this drug is now it's approved for what we've seen so far. But that raised the concern about the possible work to be done. And I think he recommended that there be a further work, first work, maybe a little bit. And I wasn't one guy on which the suggestions come from the work. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me try to address that point.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Sure, but there were more questions.
The overall data did not seem to suggest that there was a difference between the
What effect would Avandia and glycemic control as an endpoint have on the recovery process for
safety, I mentioned a couple of bands between caution about safety. First of all, is to take the data associated with this particular drug, which is in fact very complex, very complex, and very complicated. Come to an analysis of your study of what has it told us about this specific drug as it relates to its complications. Also, what has it told us about drugs that maybe are similar to it? Secondly, come to that information and put it in the context of what should be done for the action. What's the right thing to do for patients? And we have to, in that regard, weigh the benefit of what would occur if we continue to use this drug under certain circumstances and provide information to patients directly. Or if we withdraw this drug and everything else, we get what would happen to patients who are now deprived of an important therapy to control their diabetes, and what would the alternatives be? So maybe the FDA, if I'm not looking at one slice or one piece in isolation, we're looking at every piece, putting it together into a comprehensive decision on what the right thing to do is for patients. And similar drugs also been subject to that analysis by the FDA and others. And if somewhere they do, we have requested that we ran back to it. Ships the results from asking, not the results of asking, what's the problem, what is the reason, why is this happening? Well, one of the things I think your question is pointing out is the need for us to understand why that mechanism is from this drug is why I went to it. And as we learn more about the mechanisms as well as observed effects that we have in the places that we need, we'll be in a much better position to make decisions about what you say. Well, in fact, it might suggest it's a good paradigm for the world. It might conclude that the fact of microvascular treatment is important and rather than to be exposed to infection.
But you know, I'm not supposed to be that test, but you said that the FDA approves a drug only after it's actually demonstrated that drug's benefits outweigh its risks for a specific population or a specific indication and shows that the drug meets the statutory standard for safety and effectiveness. The FDA still believe that our capabilities to meet those statutory standards.
We are in the midst of the analysis as we speak, and we are right after the conclusion in order to have that final decision. Up to this point in time, we clearly have believed that it is an important part of the argument to have that issue changes in the label to provide appropriate warnings as we have the data to support it. And we'll continue to do that as the data changes or alters. I thought that the decision after this parent analysis that we're in the midst of will take appropriate action.
I guess my question is that it makes the standard continue to be
correct. ourselves to know why we have had. This is an extremely important issue for the FDA in the future in terms of our continuous improvement of how we communicate both to professionals and most importantly to patients. And patients are the diverse population. We are approaching the first of all to clarify how to do that. We've issued guidances with regard to communicating drug safety information. We now have put in place a risk communications advisory committee, and that was coming up with that. We're paying particular attention to the vehicles we're using, including our website. We're engaged in a major overhaul of the FDA website in an initial project, and that overhaul is to address the part of our website that is prepared for consumers, for patients, so that they can come to the FDA with new information in a form that is understandable and useful to them as they need to make informed decisions about the healthcare, but to do that in the context of the relationship with their physician. As doctors are caring for patients, and they're looking at those patients with diabetes who may believe are at greater risk of cardiovascular problems or already have an underlying cardiovascular history, that they would be able to make much better informed decisions about whether this drug or some alternative drug is the most appropriate treatment for that specific patient. So it arms them with more information and more awareness to make patient by patient decisions. Those signals and indications we've had with adequate scientific data,
support our conclusion. We made that conclusion. We did this step to affirm the public and positions of our work with the government.
For example, I went to my client's limit. You know, my summary is the one that I wrote the question and answer on. Basically, you're saying that again. To answer a scientific question, he's going to observe that this group already has a high risk of heart disease, and in fact, his own study, which he published, which caused this feeling to be rushed here today, 3 weeks later, is not, in fact, based on sufficient study to make. It looks like my time is coming to an end.
I apologize, I misunderstood your question. You're correct in the sense that we are in the midst of making that decision right now. Up to this point in time, we have not had sufficient data of the nature that we can rely upon to draw that conclusion. But we are assessing that as we speak. We are taking that to advisory committee to try to draw it up.
Let me change my line of questioning. If it's insufficient and premature for us to be having this hearing on this drug and this line of drugs, which I think it is, is not solid science. You're certainly not here to tell us it is. But let's go through it. I don't have a family history of diabetes, but I do have a family history of heart disease. So I just want to go through real quickly my understanding of a little bit of the history of heart disease. So it's something that's much more subtle to me in Colorado. When you were in medical school, what I did before, I can start with somebody's chest, it's pretty clear that they're in a boat stand. Based medical science at the time, and this is not a pharmaceutical per se, right? You know, there was no prescription there. But that's what they did because it was the best they could do. And looking back at probably undoubtedly cared more than say because of the risk of opening somebody's chest. Is that right?
That's a fair assessment.
Okay. And then we went through a long period of time of making that one vein and putting it into another part in hopes of catching it again. Studies show that if there's some category of patients that were likely to die in the category as a result of it later, then they are to be saved to get a normal quality of life. And having had my father go through that, they died out of the family around me. Now, my own district, there's no one who was dying with pharmaceutical fight, but it was a manufacturer of stents. So I had a COVID uncovered stent. Cases thought they would have been certain things, and now that the studies are in, at least not certain ones historically, some of them simply are not going to do a very good job for a long period of time and they'd be better off not having it. Isn't that correct? So, is it a pattern in the likely future based on that past? I'm using that anecdotal of myself. Based on that past, you're going to always be in a position in which you have to face allowing the drug. Such promise, and in fact recognizing that in the long run, maybe 15, 20 years later, the alternative to analysis, paralysis by analysis, is if you go forward with drugs that have promise, as this one does, it's showing clinical trials, it does one thing good, and then, unfortunately, over a long period of time, you may find out, as a matter of fact, about the times that I've seen it, whether in another one, you may find out that on balance, you wouldn't everything that you've been doing 10 years later, isn't that right?
It's absolutely correct.
Okay, so what I'm looking at this hearing today, because I'm a dedicated member of this committee for oversight and reform, I'm seeing two things. One is, from an oversight standpoint, we should be taking place as in the science, even though I just went through that sort of in the case of heart disease, that we have to accept that as long as you're a functional system of the child, as long as you're a functional system, is not is as good as science and minds could be, that we have to accept that there's both risk in the present process, and that 10 years from now, the number of drugs
same surveillance systems that are at the time. If we're not going to recognize the next number, just to clarify something that Representative Hammer mentioned about before, if you're actually approved, you can eliminate any test from the manufacturer that you think is pertinent to safety and effectiveness. Is that correct? Correct. Dr. Chuck has been very kind of a little bit distressing about the power of the segment.
Concerned about adverse effects on the heart.
think the point that Dr. Jenkins is making is the concern at the time about the toxicity across the board on the market is with the issue of the product, the concern is because of the nature of the drug, speak specifically to that particular individual's concerns. I'm raising a general concern that in retrospect, rather than the dynamic we're discussing today, is the issue of how tides is in different or separate from how failure is an important area that needs to be explored and concerned. And that's a parallel to this matter. I don't know that it was obviously. Market study is an extremely important tool. The information technologies are extremely important tools.
Is it a machine and black tool? Would you like to support legislation that would take advantage of it?
I would support legislation that would give us the resources to get rid of those tools and get it down to the market.
We know that those years,
With stakeholders, with especially patient groups, with FDA's ongoing investment in the environment and coming to the scientific conclusion and answer, and then whatever action we can take in the department. But to take the meantime, to also have the understanding, communicating, to prematurely and abruptly stop this medication where patients might choose to be out. Thank you.
process. So, it's not available to any physician to make findings. At the same time, we move on to an electronic manner, but we're not depending upon publication of best practices by the media and the online material electronically. So, they're going to make a change in the way that we have another publication of how it got there, but something that we need to do in real time.
Thank you.
So, to get to this point,
that's acceptable. That's a great debate. My concern is the sensationalization of the process that scares people when we have a problem with drugs. There's not much they might be looking for that as a sidebar problems with me. It's not just like you have. Thank you. sometimes it's an staff will then grant the commitment of this particular situation, indicating that if there's nobody aware, this is a good deal, that that was the correct policy. And you said that this data is confirmed with a significant concern because patients with diabetes are already at increased risk of heart disease. But I want to understand this study that GSK data that was presented in August 2006. Basically saying that if you can come across that, well, those numbers indicate that the risk went from approximately 1.5% to approximately 2%, which was approximately the increase in the risk. But that, audit data that took that as an observer in our cases, including a lot of different combinations and regimens that were being used. And so I understand some were taken in a negative light, some were taken in a negative light. So, with the fact that we have level, I'm correct in saying that, or even I'm correct in saying that, for some patients, presumably, the conclusion would be that the risk is much higher than the 2%. But we don't know, but this may have been a breakdown of those incidents. There are confidence in the environment, which means it could be a risk. Specifically to those statistical considerations as we try to make these decisions.
Right, I think what you're asking for is patients or combinations of medications that could confer higher risk. I think there are some situations where the risk is lower, and that's the kind of thing where statistical analysis is focusing. What we're trying to answer those questions, and from the answers to those questions into the larger context.
So,
yeah, I'm not going to be able to correct that.
Thank you.
struggles with the FDA to make sure that when they have safe drugs, when they're going to use them, they have proper balance to patient safety and way of safe medicine. It's an ongoing struggle. Do you think we're ready to have problems too high or just about right or too late? I mean, it's sort of, there's a lot of debate going on right now, and I think the travel is very interesting in this issue. I actually want to say, Chris, that regulatory hurdles have been closed in drugs on the market. I'd like you all, all three of you, to comment upon this, whether or not it's appropriate or not, at a regulatory level, that you're going to drug on the market, is it about right or too high?
There are some circumstances in which the regulatory barrier has to be extraordinarily high, and with regard to this risk and benefit ratio, this is one of the cases where you're talking about the regulatory cancer. So I think they have to be applicable to the individual situation and circumstances. I think it's important to point out, as I did in my own testimony, that the world around us is radically changing, rapidly changing science and technology. The complexity of the products, the circumstances, and we need that the FDA to continue to adapt and respond to these changes. And the resources that we are confirmed to are designed specifically to enable us to do that and continue to improve. So I think it's an issue of using the regulatory framework, but continuously improving it and improving our ability to apply it.
This is really a societal public policy question as far as how much certainty we've thought about government for improving, how much uncertainty we're willing to accept at the time of approval. You can never know everything about a drug at the time of approval. I think it's a public policy debate about where that standard should be set. I think we need to hear the standard that has been set for us by Congress and the statute. Thank you, Mr. Chair. General, thank you for your testimony. Much of the focus of this hearing has been on post-market surveillance. What is the FDA doing after a drug is approved? I would like to direct your attention to a slightly different question. I am specifically concerned with what the FDA does to ensure the accuracy of the pharmaceutical direct-to-consumer drug. After the company's drug has gone to market. I know in the declaration box written testimony, this statement, quote, in April 2006, the labeling for Avandia was updated to include the data in the warning section of Avandia for potential increase in heart attacks. That was the language in this declaration. There was a question by my colleague, Mr. Lynch, about the items. Now, yesterday, in both the New York Times and the Washington Post, GSK, the maker of the drug, took out front-page advertisements about it. In fact, Benjamin Hathaway, the New York Times, got it here. I think you have it in front of you. There's a front page, which has some of the top of the important safety information on the bottom. And then in the other half page, there's the patient information. Now, I'm concerned about the gap we seem to have between concern about heart attacks and warnings about heart failure.
attack means something very different than Australia, which happens to be because they are the liberals who are comfortable in that trial. I think my talk is about a certain thing specific about now, despite what you say, there are labor warnings for heart attacks. The problem is behind the New York Times and the Washington Post. What I see is a warning that says if you have heart problems or heart failure, go to the doctor. And it can cause your body to keep extra fluid, which leads to swelling and weight gain, that's a problem. Extra body fluid can make some heart problems or some heart failure. The word heart attack, which is what consumers understand, doesn't appear. The GSK spent $42 million in advertisements to consumers. The pandemic, its revenue has increased 25% in recent years. If I'm right, and if this doesn't continue, consumers about heart attacks. Do you believe that consumers understand this warning that GSK to be warning that there is an increased risk with heart attacks for the enemy? Also, I do not believe that looking at the world like this in the most important ways to provide the kind of platform understanding that you just described. I think that this is not a good. So, this item doesn't use the word heart attacks, does it? I haven't had the complete answer, so I don't take the word that does not. Because I'm happy to represent that we have an absolute assurance that it doesn't use the word heart attacks. Now, in that way, if there is concern, as we now know, about the increased risk of heart attacks, that's what you're talking about. In your testimony, that's what's talking about in history. These companies still have warning consumers about the increased risk of heart attacks. My question to you is, as a regulatory agency, do they have enough power here to do something about the manufacturers and what they're doing with those consumer advertisers? Do you need more power? Do you need different power? What needs to be done for you to adequately regulate how the manufacturers are communicating in simple, plain terms that consumers will understand? As part of the negotiations and discussions with regard to the district for reorganization, which is currently in place, and we have sought the resources to be able to expand the ability to review, survey, and therefore take action against the direct-to-consumer advocate. So, with great respect, this would raise the ability to answer my comment, Mr. Kearney's question. He asked you a direct question. You said, we're looking for more resources. Now, to me, resources means maybe people, maybe it means money. By resources, do you mean some more regulatory power that you currently do not have to interface with the drug manufacturers to make sure that they are doing what they need to do to tell consumers about the risks you're flagging? I believe right now the most serious concern for me is having adequate numbers of people to be able to monitor and take action against direct-to-consumer advertising rights in our country. That, for me, is a major area that needs to be addressed. The ability to get to the effect if that becomes a problem that requires legislation is something that I think has indicated. But I'm not prepared at the present time to say that's actually the answer that we need in order to fix the concern and problem that's being raised. I'm not sure I understand you, but I just follow up briefly on one question. Are you telling me that you don't have enough people to read this ad and see whether or not the ad adequately, in your expert opinion, warns the consumer of the increased risk of heart attack? You don't have enough people to do that. But also, don't have any more resources to be able to direct the issue of the FDA's oversight of direct-to-consumer advertising. Do you understand? Yes, sir. Can I just have one last question, Mr. Chairman? Thank you. You may not be able to make the data. Fine. Do you have the power you can need to say the drug manufacturer fix the data? I believe that the present time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
step back, it was like it was inappropriate and unfortunate that an actual private individual like me as a guy has been incorporated into us for less than 14.
I have last question for you before this meeting is why I have distinguished professor commands. Institutions should be proud of the work that it did. And we as a country should not tolerate efforts by the private or public entities that engage in intimidation and smear campaigns against experts who act in the service of the public. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. I assure you, you are the members of the committee. There is absolutely no intention, nor has there been any action on the part of the FDA. I believe the FDA wants to accept information and be able to provide their sources and analyze it appropriately and then take what we believe to be the appropriate action.
Well, I think that's your comment there. I mean, after all, the release of the study, there have been a number of articles written about the failures of the study and what is missing from the study. Is that something important for consumers to be aware of?
Well, I think it's important for everyone to be aware of the balance of what is scientific debate. It should be something that is real, that people are aware of. There are issues here where, for example, two drugs that are each highly regulated have different perspectives and points of view with regard to this particular study. I think that's an important part of the idea of the bio-level discussion. Chairman of the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine at the Cleveland Clinic, one of the nation's most respected academic medical centers, is the Vice President of the American College of Cardiology. And from 2000 to 2005, Dr. Wilson served as a member of the FDA's Cardiovascular Advisory Panel on the Chair of the Committee during his final year. And Dr. Wilson was the lead author of the May 21 New England Journal of Medicine article of the direct connection between Avandia and increased cardiac risk. We have also Dr. Cynthia, who is professor of medicine, epidemiology, and health services, and co-director of the cardiovascular health research unit at the University of Washington. From 2000 to 2006, he was a member of the Institute of Medicine's Committee on the Assessment of the U.S. Drug Safety System. Dr. Cynthia was the lead author for the May 21st editorial in the New England Journal of Medicine, commenting on Dr. Wilson's study, and is the lead author of one of the June 5th editorials in the same journal, commenting on the New England's record study. And Dr. John Wilson is a professor of medicine at the University of North Carolina School of Medicine in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where he serves as chief of the division of endocrinology, one of our nation's most highly respected experts on diabetes care. Dr. Pierce is president-elect of the American Diabetes Association. He's received numerous awards and honors, including citation of best doctors in America every year since 2001. Dr. Pierce was the first position of the country to raise concerns about the cardiovascular safety of the vaccine in a letter he wrote to the FDA in 2000. We work with three of you as the practice of our committee to the next five witnesses to protect an health and the working group. I'm sorry, this will have the first one.
We began with noting that there were more
these initial clinical trials. But we still do not have enough clinical trial data to form any reasonable scientific conclusions. Eventually, in April 2007, we discovered a Access the Climb website that disclosed basic information and summarized results for clinical trials conducted by the company. Now we had access to the heart attack and death rates for all relevant 42 Avandia clinical trials completed before or after drug approval. We completed the meta-analysis that showed a 43% excess incidence of heart attack in Avandia treated patients, which was statistically significant with a p-value of 0.03. A p-value of 0.03 means that there is a 97% probability that the results of the study are not due to chance alone. We submitted a manuscript reporting our findings to the New England Medicine, where the manuscript was peer-reviewed and published online on May 21st, 2007. In our manuscript, we were careful to point out the strengths and limitations of our analysis. Because our access to data was limited to publicly available clinical trial data, we could not analyze original patient-level information. In addition, as we pointed out, the meta-analysis disclosure is less convincing than a large prospective trial designed to answer a specific scientific question. Nonetheless, we thought the findings were sufficiently important to warrant prompt publication and conclude, quote, until more precise estimates of the cardiovascular risk of this treatment can be delineated in patients with diabetes, patients and providers should carefully consider the potential risks of rosiglitazone in the treatment of type 2 diabetes. The same 42 trials that we include in our analysis are available to the company and to the FDA. Because both of these organizations have access to raw patient data, they can perform more statistically powerful analyses, which can help clarify the extent of risk. GSK has reported the basic results of their own patient-level meta-analysis on the clinical trials website, which confirms the statistically significant increase in heart-related complications in patients who received Avandia. The FDA also recently announced that their own internal analysis of patient-level data confirms an approximately 40% excess of heart-related complications. However, neither the GSK nor FDA analyses have been published. It is therefore not possible to directly compare the results from three of these analyses. I look forward to discussing these findings and the policy implications with the committee during the course of today's series. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much. Is it not one of these? Chairman, we're actually members of the committee. It is really an honor to be able to testify before this committee. This statement in my testimony does not reflect the opinions of the Grand Prairie University of Arthritis School of Medicine, where the American Diabetes Association of Voluntary and Work Agency for which I serve as an officer. Second, I've been working in the clinical class since approximately 1992. I have a number of conflicts of interest in that regard, and I've tried to expand both a bit of my written statement, but I don't want to go into that in detail because of my time limitations. So I can give you some background as to how I got involved in this process. In June of 1999, I was invited to give about six presentations at the American Diabetes Association meetings and the American Society's meetings. And I got around to the same databases with the same materials that Dr. Nissen spoke about earlier. I was concerned about the potential of cardiovascular safety because of what I perceived to be an increase in cholesterol. It was relatively specific to Avandia and one of the limited agents that had been working in the United States, Avandia Actives and Wiser. Because of that, I looked for signals of cardiovascular safety and found the signal with regards to the comparison between Avandia and some kind of active platforms in the initial Avandia data set. I realized it was potentially an explosive issue with the data with colleagues and with scientists who spent time direction.
Thank you.
decisions about safety matters. We need to turn our focus on our goal to an increase in our robust public health focus. Public health conducted in meta-analysis, which is a method of summarizing cases that conduct the trials. In that analysis, the data was associated with a significant increase in the risk of heart attacks. In other words, the data increases the risk by about as much as statin lipid-lowering drugs reduce the risk of heart attacks. The main limitations of Dr. Wilson's meta-analysis were the quantity and quality of the available data. The responsibility for the limited availability of high-quality data resided with GSK, which did not conduct studies to definitively address heart attack risk in a timely fashion. The regulatory history of Avandia includes several key risk opportunities. It was approved on the basis of the ability to lower blood glucose, because high levels of blood glucose increase the risks of vascular disease. The glucose-lowering drug is presumed to reduce the risk of a heart attack. Paradoxically, Avandia appears to increase rather than decrease this risk. GSK did not make a serious effort to verify the presumed health benefits of Avandia in a timely fashion. The ADOPT and the CLEAN trials focused largely on marketing questions that failed to address directly questions of heart attack risk or benefit. The drugs that will be used by billions of people for many years, it is essential to document the health risks and benefits of therapies approved on the basis of surrogate endpoints. If sponsors do not monitor the admission of large long-term trials of public health reports, then the FDA needs the authority to insist that they do so in a timely fashion. In August 2006, GSK provided the FDA and the European Medicines Agency, the European equivalent of the FDA, with the results of several studies, including a meta-analysis similar to Dr. Wilson's. By October 2006, the product labels in Europe were revised to include this information. There was no uproar in Europe at this time when the right labels were revised. The product label in the U.S. still does not identify heart attack risk as a potential adverse event in the general population of diabetics. It's not clear why the FDA failed to make this information public before Dr. Wilson's meta-analysis was published. The primary measure of regulatory success is the timeliness of information warnings and reserves. With Avandia, the FDA failed to warn or inform in a timely fashion. GSK has run a record study of several major limitations in design and conduct, and even if it continues to the planned conclusion, information about heart attack risk is likely to be incomplete. Last weekend, after incorporating the final results of the record trial into the meta-analysis, Avandia is still associated with a 33% increased risk of heart attack. The possibility of heart attack benefit seems remote, and there is a statistically significant evidence of harm. Late and incomplete evaluations of health risks and benefits drugs such as Avandia create concern, confusion, and uncertainty among patients, physicians, and policymakers. The House of Representatives, which is about to take up drug safety legislation, has a unique opportunity to prevent future drug safety problems and to reinvigorate an essential regulatory agency that has many outstanding scientists. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to say I'll start with questions. So, I appreciate you being here. Dr. Diaz, I'd like to start with you because as far as I can determine, you're the first outside person outside of FDA to suggest that the first marketing trial to determine the risk of heart attacks and stroke and patients who are taking the vaccine. Specifically, we recommended that the FDA work to encourage cardiovascular safety trials in high-risk populations, particularly with Avandia, where we believe there is ample cause for concern without objection. I'd like to put the full text of the FDA in March 15th, 2000 in the record. So far,
to drug safety, it's additional Regulatory agency, okay, a lot of To the majority
discuss to anyone here as you were trying to get a political design to work to get your information. Did anyone suggest that you ask the FDA to assist you? Okay. So it very much looks like this was a political attitude designed to rather to make a big public splash. It's clear from letters that I have here. And in fact, before even starting this published, we were asked to ask for a hearing. So in fact, didn't you reach a conclusion back in February that this was, in your opinion, a potentially dangerous drug, and decide that you wanted to bring shed light on it using this body in a public hearing? And you're right. Didn't you decide that already back in February? Why did not come to that conclusion to refresh the analysis? Okay, so what we did in February when you were saying you were concerned and asking for this information from the political body rather than, in fact, from the fundamental group that we hold accountable to, I had incomplete information for them to allow access to all 42 clinical trials. And then you haven't asked the FDA for it. You asked the FDA. The FDA is not allowed to do that. To the FDA.
So I said, look, we have a concern that I didn't make a decision. This is Participation, ironically enough, if the FDA is Mr. Chairman, and members of the committee, thank you for having me here today. My name is Alison Slaughter, and I'm the chairman of the Research and Development of the Access Network of GSK. I'm here to share with you GSK's extensive online efforts to research both the safety and the benefits of Avandia, the important medicine that helps patients fight the devastating effects of type 2 diabetes. GSK has initiated the most comprehensive research program for any high-impact diabetic medicines available to date, with experience of over 52,000 patients studied in clinical trials. By doing so, GSK has already been determining what Congress has suggested all pharmaceutical companies should do, that is, rigorous scientific studies of the medicine safety and benefit after it is approved by the FDA. The data we have collected from these studies not only confirm that others might exceed the toiling blood glucose levels in diabetes patients, but this data also showed that Avandia controls blood sugar for longer periods than other currently available parameters to diabetes medicine. Avandia has shown 30% and 60% superior efficacy to metformin and to sulfonylureas, the two most commonly used parameters to diabetes medicines. As concerns the very important point of safety, the totality of the data we have generated over the last 8 years establishes that when compared to other widely used or oral diabetes medicines, Avandia is not associated with an increased risk of death, including death from a cardiovascular event. The data also show that except for the well-described increased risk for congestive heart failure associated with this class of medicines, which is not tested with Avandia, Avandia has a comparable cardiovascular safety profile to that of the most widely used oral antidiabetes medicine. Let me take you through this. From day one, GSK and regulatory agencies believed it was important to develop the highest level of scientific evidence to assess the cardiovascular benefit to risk profile of Avandia. Accordingly, in the year 2000 and again in the year 2001, we cited two very large prospective objective trials, respectively, in our doctor and the record studies. Both trials allow us to compare over a period of 3 to 4 years the safety of Avandia to that of the two most widely used oral antidiabetes medicine, each in more than 4,000 diabetes patients. Specifically, the primary goal of the record study was to compare the risk of cardiovascular deaths and cardiovascular hospitalization in these patients, including myocardial, stroke, congestive heart failure in patients using Avandia or patients using other medicines. Importantly, given the length of these prospective clinical studies, we did not use SEDA and rely on other medical studies to collect. We proactively use other available scientific methodologies, what they most robust in the prospective clinical trials, which is not the discussions around the analysis. So, assess Avandia's cardiovascular safety profile. We ran other analytical analysis in 2005 already, and also in 2006, which we knew would be useful for generating hypotheses, yes, but not for providing definitive answers. We also ran a very large real-world epidemiological study in over 33,000 diabetes patients. And that study showed that there was an increased risk for Avandia. While the meta-analysis conducted in 2005 and 2006 did suggest a potential increase in cardiovascular patients using Avandia, among other more robust scientific evidence that we have, and that's coming from four independent high-level scientific experimentation. Three large trials, the ABOT trial, the PLAN trial, the RECORD trial, and the large epidemiological study that I just spoke about. All those studies have shown that the hypothesis was not accurate in terms of increase of cardiovascular risk associated with the use of the data. When we compare it to the two most widely used oral diabetes medicines. Throughout the study, we also communicated diligently with the FDA. The data that we received from the meta-analysis, it was validly published in the same study and the other study. We worked in the journals and we posted all our clinical trial results as well as our meta-analysis on GSK's clinical trial registry, actually in October 2006, well before the publication of the New England Journal of Medicine. We also diligently communicated to physicians and patients about this scientifically established safety risk. In summary, at every step, GSK examined the questions generated by our meta-analysis and by that of others, and they determined that more robust scientific data consistently conflicted with the signals raised. The complete body of evidence available to date clearly supports our conviction that the cardiovascular safety of Avandia is comparable to that of the two most widely used oral anti-diabetes medicines. As we all work together here today on this issue, I do ask that we all remind them that we are working on behalf of diabetic patients who are at risk of many, many, many major complications. Oversight, kidney failure, renal amputation, myocardial blindness, cardiovascular events, deaths. Unfortunately, the worldwide epidemic of type 2 diabetes shows no signs of abating. All medicines have risks, but the benefits of oral anti-diabetic medicines like Avandia help millions of patients control their diabetes and live better and more productive life. I must say that we found the record data that we published yesterday morning in the Journal of Medicine very reassuring, recognizing that it is the time and therefore not to be conclusive. We are extremely disappointed by the editorials published yesterday in the New England Journal of Medicine that showed that clinical trials, where the data taken as a whole, support the safety profile of Avandia. But thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As well as cardiovascular disease.
Essentially, by definition, for the FDA to prove the efficacy has already been established, and that is a really unfortunate statement since it flies in the very face of the approval process.
This is actually true, and I would like to add Congressman, that not only is it effective, it's actually superior to the most likely used medicines. It's, as I said, 30% and 60% superior.
Now, you know, I've been talking about this being a political point since then. I'm not going to back away from that because I think, unfortunately, we're playing science here when, in fact, we should be, let me just ask you one question. How do you believe doctors and statisticians should handle meta analysis results prior to receiving data from large clinical trials? And we don't want to rely on the public unnecessarily or needlessly, but we also don't want to seek patients not have facts as soon as we have them. So how should this be done in general? How should this have been presented if you don't believe it was presented appropriately by medical data or retarded methods? And in fact, publishing without dealing with your company or your family.
Congressman, like not to go out on exactly what Dr. Lisa has done, I'll tell you what I want. In 2004, we knew that it was important for us to continuously look at the cardiovascular safety of Avandia. Actually, as of 1999, we had a very stringent pharmacologic system that looks at cases of cardiovascular deaths or cardiovascular deaths, etc., to assess whether there was an imbalance. We have not seen such imbalance. Yet there was some report in some patient population, combination of insulin with cyclodextrin. However, we knew exactly what we were dealing with. As our hypothesis generated technologies, methodology is unlike facts establishing methodologies. So they did that analysis and they immediately came with another scientific strategy, which was a real life epidemiologic study of 33,000 patients that was shown absolutely no increased risk. We communicated both information to the agency, I think, with the
questions to the point. I don't want to get into the secret work you're doing, but I'm assuming that with TCE having had, we believe that a side effect, in other words, that it can have secondary effects, as a client is not your drug, but all the drugs, would it be reasonable to say yes if you do that? And you're working on next generation that's going to reduce that need of IV by treatment, but there's a class of drug. What about the basic tendency of TCE is to have this potential side effect? Is that true?
Congressman, there are sex as well as many other companies have continued to work on second generations.
Now, there's been a lot of talk about statistics, but if in fact this study was normalized for the fact that TCE have a certain higher risk, at least anecdotally, that's believed that they can do. If it had been reduced for that, wouldn't in fact the study have had different outcomes? And I'm only asking for one reason. Isn't it true you could have sliced the statistics several different ways to get maybe much less alarming and yet equally accurate statistics?
Congressman, may I imagine that was good as the study you put into it? The studies that we, the FDA, Dr. Wilson, have put into the meta analysis, the raw materials that you have for which the technology lies. What about this actually good for cardiovascular events? We heard experts here talking about adjudication of cases. The cases were not adjudicated. So the starting material, the raw material, is not designed for the question that's being asked. But right away to ask the question, Congressman, that prospective control of large studies, we have two of them. The three studies do not show a significant increase in cardiovascular events. We think it's very clear evidence and it seems to be forward to the discussion with the FDA advisory committee on the effective
to have that scientific data. I think that's how you should answer Mr. McKinnon. I appreciate that you're here to recognize me. I've got one question to get me. GSK was one of the first pharmaceutical companies, I believe the first pharmaceutical company,
Thank you. Thank you.
some investigation.
Passionate about his work, he dedicated his life to the working jobs, and as scientists,